This is Where We Live on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. Is Connecticut's brew scene still hopping in 2022? A dozen breweries closed in our state since the start of the pandemic, according to the Connecticut Brewers Guild, but another 22 opened. Coming up Where We Live, we check in on the $3 billion craft brew industry in Connecticut, an industry that employs nearly 18,000. Now, challenges remain for breweries, like ingredient costs rising, a continued labor shortage, and now reports of carbon dioxide shortages in our region. Brewers Guild Executive Director Phil Pappas joins us with more. That's just ahead. First, there's a local scholarship program to encourage Black students to join the brewing industry. A Connecticut resident who's worked in the beer industry since he was 18 started the collaboration. Joining us now on Zoom is Jamal Robinson, Director of Sales and Marketing at New England Brewing Company, also known as NEBCO. That's in Woodbridge, Connecticut. Jamal was recently recognized as one of Hartford Business Journal's annual 40 Under 40. Jamal, welcome and congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Our listeners can join as well, 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. Or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Let us know what local craft breweries you visit near where you live. Now, Jamal, I mentioned that you helped start up a scholarship program to encourage Black students to join the brewing industry. When you look at the craft brewing industry in Connecticut, is it still predominantly white? And how did you get into it?
Yeah, it's absolutely predominantly white. And I got into the industry because I was working at a Jewish deli. So I was in a very white space. I was a server at a deli, and the GM, or the VP of an Anheuser-Busch wholesaler, was one of the regulars that sat in my section all the time. I thought I was a great guy and a great kid, and gave me an internship, gave me an opportunity to get into the industry.
So what does it look like now in our state? I understand, are there only two Black-owned breweries?
Yes, as far as I know, in Connecticut, yeah.
And so when we talk about the scholarship opportunity that you launched, you know, what was happening around that time that made you, you know, talk with people that you knew in the industry to make this happen?
So, you know, during COVID, I think a lot of us, me like a lot of us, had a lot of time to think and took that time to think to really, especially just thinking and seeing where we are in the industry. It was kind of a call to action on my own. Thought about myself, thought about my role in this industry that I've been in for a long time, thought about all the protests that were going on, so my role in Black community and in my own community here in New Haven. And there was just a call to action and a need. So I sat with our director team and we talked about what we could do, what was our role in all of this. We do a lot for charity and we do a lot for community in general, but we didn't have anything focused on Black community. And that was important. So we started what we call our Equality Committee, which is essentially a diversity inclusion, diversity, equity, and inclusion committee, where we focus specifically on, when we first started focusing specifically on trying to diversify the industry and what would that look like, trying to bring some awareness to racial injustice and trying to help elevate Black communities in our area. We're in Woodbridge. New England Brewing is right on the border of Woodbridge and New Haven. So Black community is right here. It's where we are. And it felt necessary and important to do something like that. And our director team agreed, and we all sat down and was like, okay, what could we do? And what would that mean? And our once we started our equality committee, which ended up being about half our employees here at NEBCO, one of the first things to tack that Sacred Heart University had a brewing science program that had just recently started that year. And we wanted to reach out to them to see if there was possibility in helping us start a scholarship, you know, diversifying who's brewing in the industry and what that means and what that looks like. So after we reached out, they were all on board. We started the process of figuring out what that really means to start a scholarship. And we ended up starting two scholarships. One is an annual scholarship that New England Brewing funds. And really proud of our team for being on board with that. The Brewing Science Program is a $15,000 program. So when we talk about someone of color who is not necessarily entrenched in the craft beer scene, certainly coming from a different industry or career choice, $15,000 is a real number. $15,000 program and 11 months to actually go through the program. So it was important to us that we paid the full tuition fee and gave someone, took that weight off of someone to really be able to jump in and to be passionate about this industry. But we also, in talking with Phil Pappas, the director of the Connecticut Brewers Guild. He and I are friends, and we started talking one day. And once he found out about our scholarship and what we were doing, he expressed how this is something that the Guild should be a part of. And I agreed, and we started talking about what that would mean on the next steps. So we started creating an endowed scholarship, which means the interest that you raise for that scholarship spins off to pay for that scholarship annually. So for us to pay for a $15,000 program in perpetuity, it would mean we'd have to raise $250,000 as a collective. So that kind of spearheaded where we set a goal to raise $50,000 a year over the course of 5 years. And in the meantime, New England Brewing is putting up an annual scholarship for those 5 years so that we didn't have to wait 5 years to start impacting what this industry looks like.
That's great to hear, Jamal. So this is the NEBCO African American Brewers Scholarship and also the Connecticut Brewers Guild African American Brewing Scholarships. We're going to have information on our website, ctpublic.org/where we live, for our listeners to learn more. And so tell me about what the response was like. And again, your goal was to put through one student a year. And what kind of results did you see?
We had incredible results. A lot of the industry kind of showed up for this one, and people started reaching out, asking how they could get involved, how they could support. Athletic Brewing reached out and wanted to add another annual scholarship to the whole program. So we were putting two students through. So there is also Athletic Brewing 5 year annual scholarship that has started as well. And then on top of that, we've got support from Two Roads and from a lot of other breweries, Great Falls, Rhythm Brewing, and a bunch of other breweries that have jumped on board and wanting to be a part of this initiative overall. So with the help of Two Roads last year, we actually were able to put four students through the program, two of which were Black women. And that's just an incredible thing when we think about the brewing industry in Connecticut being obviously a very predominantly white space.
Mm. When you talked about, of the four students, two were Black women. Can you tell me about them and, their response to having this opportunity?
I think they love the experience. They love the opportunity to be able to do that. And one of the things I've heard from them is, the expectation of not exactly knowing what to expect coming into this industry, but have been met with pure positivity, and it's not the kind of, it's kind of, it could have the stigma of being kind of a bro-y, bearded scenario, but a lot of people have really been helpful, and what I've heard from them is that they've loved the community that they've been a part of. They love the fact of everyone reaching out to them and helping them along the way, everything they've learned, but specifically the community. It's one of the things that I love the most about this industry is it's filled with great people, and it's got this help each other rise kind of mentality. When I started off my career with Anheuser-Busch, it was a very corporate, brand loyal kind of mentality. You only drink our beers and that's it. And you don't talk to the other breweries, but craft beer is pretty much the exact opposite. The whole industry helps each other out. If someone needs hops or someone needs grain, you can reach out to another brewery and they can help out in the short term with that. Not to mention just drinking each other's beer. So having people of color coming into this industry and getting the same response and the same feelings that I've been a part of since I've been in it is pretty awesome.
You're hearing Jamal Robinson here on Where We Live, Director of Sales and Marketing at New England Brewing Company, or NEBCO, in Woodbridge, Connecticut, as we focus on the craft brew industry in our state. First off, learning about efforts that Jamal has led to work on collaboration and work on diversifying the local craft brew industry. You can join us. Again, we'd love to hear from you about some of the craft breweries that you visit, where you live, or just about the industry in general. Our number 888-720-9677, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. So it's great to hear about that collaboration and these different scholarships, but it sounds like it doesn't stop there. There's something called Change in the Air Festival. Tell us about that.
Yeah, absolutely. So when we started the endowed scholarship, it was important that this wasn't just a New England Brewing initiative, that this was an industry initiative. If we're really trying to change the feel and the energy and the shape of what this industry looks like, it takes a lot more than one brand. So I started reaching out to friends in the industry, started fielding some calls from people in the industry, and started a committee of folks to really focus on the fundraising efforts of the endowed scholarship. $250,000 is a lot of money. And we've got a as a brand and individually, we've been doing a lot of things to try and raise that money, but it was important that we got everybody involved. So especially like when someone of color coming into an industry that they're not necessarily familiar with, I think it's important that they don't just see one or two breweries a part of that, but they see this industry that is embracing this movement. That certainly makes something feel more welcoming and be more welcoming overall. So as we were talking about different fundraising efforts, one of the things that a lot of places do is just throw a charity golf tournament, right? It's a pretty standard fundraiser for a lot of organizations. So we talked about that briefly. And in reality, we realized that, A, this isn't something that people of color strive to go to. And two, it's not super inclusive. It doesn't really fit the mission of what we're trying to do overall. So we started talking about throwing a beer festival. You know, that's something we do. We're all in the industry. We've all been to beer fests. We know it's a great time. And we started talking about, all right, if we're going to throw a beer festival, it really shouldn't be what your traditional beer festival is, because that's a pretty predominantly white space. And then that defeats the purpose of what we're trying to do here. So we started thinking about what that would mean, what could happen at a beer fest, the conversations we'd want to happen, the feel and the energy. And as we started batting around ideas, what came to mind is a festival called Fresh Fest that's out in Pittsburgh. And it's called Barrel and Flow now, but it's a Black-owned brew fest filled with Black-owned breweries from all around the country and filled with collaborations. All these breweries collaborate. It's got art and music, and it's a very, very cool space, and it's been voted one of the best beer fests in the country. So that was kind of the blueprint and gave us the mindset, like, this is something that could happen. And especially if we're trying to diversify who's brewing in the industry, it's important that we diversify who's drinking beer, and that we change what the spaces look like. Like I said before, I got in this industry being in a very white space. And I think it's important that we look to change and create new spaces so that white spaces aren't the only way to get into this industry. So the festival is as much a fundraiser, it's also an opportunity to bring craft beer into a very comfortable space for people of color. So all of our musicians, our artists, all of our pop-up vendors, all the food vendors are all Black and brown owned. And then we have 25 of Connecticut and outside the region, some of the best breweries in this area, and brought craft beer into a space for people of color instead of the other way around, trying to throw this beer fest and invite Black folks to come to that.
So that was in June. What was the response, Jamal?
Yeah, we did that on June 19th, and it was a great response. We sold over 500 tickets. We raised $15,000, and more than anything, we threw just a great party, a great vibe. And the response I hear from people of color, A, being that, man, I didn't know this type of thing existed. They got an opportunity to try beers they wouldn't have tried before, which is exactly what a beer fest is supposed to be. You know, this is when beer fests first started happening in Connecticut, and I was working for Blue Point Brewing and pouring beers. It was kind of this surreal scene that you could try 20, 30, 40 different breweries and the four or five beers that they brought to the table that day and really figure out what you like and really get involved as a whole, as opposed to going to a package store and committing to a whole six pack. So, but over the time, you've got a lot of beer geeks, you got a lot of people that are in the industry and in and around it now. So it doesn't necessarily have that same feel. And what I heard the most from brewers was like, man, this felt like the old beer fest again. People were coming up, asking questions, wanting information, wanting to know what's in this beer and what it's about, and not just kind of running to the brewery that's got the most hype at the time. And then from people, from white folks that have been to all these beer fests before, I heard a lot of feedback from them being like, this is the best beer fest I've ever been to. It's just more fun. There's DJs playing hip hop and R&B. There's people dancing. There's this atmosphere and this vibe and this energy that's infectious and fun and welcoming all the way around. And then you've got this really diverse crowd of Black, brown, white, Asian, everyone just in this space enjoying a collective of the culture and the beer all in the same space. And it was cool. I've been in this is my 18th year in craft beer business, and I've never felt more welcome and more at home than I did the first year at Changing the Air Festival, and that was a pretty powerful feeling for me.
So you're really starting to see a difference between, you know, a brand just saying that they're trying to be inclusive to actually, you know, putting forth money and effort to affect that change, Jamal.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a reality to, I think most of this industry is welcoming by nature. That is the intention. That's how they feel. But I try to explain to people that if you know, especially if I'm talking to white folks, if I say, you know, picture yourself walking into a space, walking into a restaurant that you've heard the food is really good, but you don't know anything else about the culture really. And you walk in and no one in there looks like you. They're not playing any of the music that you listen to. And you definitely get a couple of looks from people, whether that's a look like, huh, that's interesting, you're here, or why are you here? And maybe it's not even an aggressive look, but it's certainly attention that you get when you walk in, is your first instinct to feel comfortable. You know, I think as a human being, no one immediately walks into that situation and their first instinct is like, I feel comfortable here. And I think that's a part of what we talk about when we're trying to create new spaces, is that it's not just saying that you're welcoming to all. It's doing things that intentionally embrace other cultures and other people to instill the fact that you are welcoming, because you're creating things that isn't just built for one demographic, but it's built for everyone. And that's a big part of what Changing the Air Fest is.
So hopefully happening again next year, Jamal.
That's the plan. onward and upward. Our goal, we've actually been able to start. So the committee that started the festival and have been fundraising, we've actually filed the paperwork to become a nonprofit 501c3, because we've got bigger goals outside of just the scholarship. Once we can fund that endowed scholarship, it's a bigger initiative. We think about the fact that, again, if we want to diversify who's in the industry, most of us that are in the industry aren't actual brewers. Like myself and a lot of my colleagues are sales and marketing, and it's tap room and packaging line and so forth. So we'd like to evolve to be able to create internships and create other opportunities to get into the brewing industry besides just being a brewer. There's this, like we said, it's a $3 million, $3 billion industry here in Connecticut, and there's a lot of opportunity outside of just brewing beer.
So, you know, again, the scholarship helping to pay for students to go through, or part of paying for them to go through the brewing science program at Sacred Heart. But when you think about expansion, so thinking about ways to help people pursue other degrees like marketing?
Yeah, or at least, you know, getting internships and getting involved, building those relationships between good brands and getting people, getting their foot in the door. You know, a lot of the people I know that are in the industry didn't necessarily go to college, get a degree in craft beer, and then get into the industry. It's built on relationships. It's built on experiences. It's built on connecting those relationships to those experiences and then getting an opportunity. And that's exactly how I did. I left college to get into, to stay in the beer business. And my trajectory through the last 18 years have been built on work ethic and relationships and trying to do the right thing and being good at the gig. But I think that's the same story for a lot of people that are in the industry. So we don't want to pigeonhole that transition to just being, you have to take this 15-month brewing science program to get into the business, because many of us haven't gotten in that way.
So Change in the Air Festival, the hope is to turn it into a foundation. And the origin of the name, Jamal, tell us a little bit more.
So when we first started the scholarship, we did a collaboration with Dockside Brewing down in Milford. And we brought in Karim, who is our scholarship recipient from last year. He also is one of the only other Black-owned breweries in the state, Best Friends Lunch. He's making some really good beer. You should try his stuff if you haven't. But we got together and we're talking about the collaboration and what the name of that beer would be. And we released that beer on Juneteenth of 2021. And Karim actually came up with that name. And he was like, you know, if we're trying to be intentionally symbolic here, if you're thinking about a free slave that just found out that they're free for the first time and taking that breath of fresh air for the first time as a free human being, what that must have felt like. But then also the transition of what we're trying to do in this industry and really changing the air, changing the landscape of the industry and the feel of the industry overall. It was just a perfect name for that collaboration. And then when we started talking about the festival, it felt like it didn't make a lot of sense to try and reinvent the wheel. It was a perfect name that really hit home and what we're trying to accomplish overall. So we stuck with that name.
You're hearing Jamal Robinson here on Where We Live, Director of Sales and Marketing at New England Brewing Company. He's going to stay with us, and after the break, we'll continue talking about the craft brew industry in our state, also how the industry pivoted during the pandemic and how the industry continues to grow with new breweries. We're going to be hearing from the Connecticut Brewers Guild, and we'll take your questions too, 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Listening to Where We Live on Connecticut Public. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. The Brewers Association tracks national beer sales and production annually. We spoke with Bart Watson, the chief economist and lead author on a new report, who noted that despite losses during the pandemic, craft beer business nationwide had mostly rebounded. Here's more from Watson.
What we saw during COVID wasn't necessarily a drop in the overall consumption of beer, but just a radical change in where we bought it. So we bought a lot more beer at the grocery store, you know, package form, and we bought a lot less beer at bars and restaurants. And that shift in particular was really hard for craft brewers, since they tend to sell a lot more draft beer as well as at their breweries. And largely, you know, we're seeing people come back to their previous patterns of shopping that they had pre-COVID.
Are you one of them? You can join us too, 888-720-9677, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. We wanted to understand the changes seen in Connecticut's brewing industry since the pandemic. So joining us now on Zoom is Phil Pappas, Executive Director of the Connecticut Brewers Guild. Phil, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
So I understand the guild started in 2012. So what was it, like maybe less than a dozen breweries at that time? And now how many do we have?
Yeah, we back in short 10 years ago, we only had about 8 to 10 breweries. And today we're standing 125 strong.
That's amazing in a decade. And so when we think about the last 2.5 years that you've spoken through your role about the challenges breweries have faced, from can shortages to various state mandates. And so how would you describe the challenges being seen now?
Yeah, absolutely. The last 2.5 years, like everybody in every business, we've dealt with a lot of the challenges COVID has hit us with. But along with that, to your statement, has been a lot of secondary and third degree effects through our supply chain. So a lot of, Ball, one of the largest can manufacturers in the world, set very high minimums for ordering at 1 million cans. And a lot of our small breweries, no brewery in Connecticut, goes through that. And so they would have to spend an egregious amount of money on cans to either sit in store and not go through them within 5 or maybe even 10 years. And so we've also seen raw ingredient increases as well through hops and grain. And of course, now we're seeing a CO2 shortage that we're going to see either a very long period of time that we may have to have a shortage of CO2, or the cost of CO2 is going to significantly increase as well.
I wanted to get more into that in just a little bit, Phil. But, you know, backing up to when we think about the restrictions placed on businesses, especially during the peak of the pandemic, the way that breweries were able to open or stay in business, can you talk about some of those mandates and where they stand now?
Yeah, absolutely. So a lot of the mandates that we saw were 6-foot distancing rules between tables and chairs, no seating at the bar unless there was plexiglass at least 30 inches high, food requirement. That was the biggest one that hit our industry. A lot of our breweries were forced to serve food to our patrons. And a lot of the breweries work with third parties in terms of food trucks, caterers and local restaurant delivery. And we had to have food on site available during the entire time that we were open. And that was a mandate for about 6 to 7 months. So breweries either had to rely on someone else coming in. And if a food truck ended up, having some sort of cancellation, and whether they were unable to show up, or that maybe they had a family medical emergency, or COVID hit their family or friends, or they were exposed, they had to cancel. And then the brewery were forced to close the entire day that day because they didn't have food on site. So they lost an entire day of sales due to something like that. So a lot of the breweries had to incur food programs themselves and take on the additional cost of that, while we also saw the increase in raw products and raw ingredients for food as well. And so we saw that happen for about, like I said, 6 to 7 months, until December 2nd, when Governor Lamont decided to implement the rule that it had to be food of substantial matter. So it didn't just have to be any sort of food, even though we were providing that. It had to be, you know, a salad with protein. It had to be a piece of cake or something larger. And it had to be these additional really restrictive food requirements, even though there was real no change in COVID at that time.
What was the reason for that?
My understanding from in all of our discussions with Governor Lamont and David Lehman and the reopening committee was to prevent potential for intoxication. And they believed that if people were having some alcohol or having some beer, that they would forget about the rules and come within 6 feet of people. We highly argued that, and we have extremely trained staff on site. All of our brewery taproom staff and all of our brewers are TIPS certified. I'm a TIPS trainer, so we went around and make sure everybody was updated in their training to prevent over intoxication. It's something we deal with every single day. You know, we serve alcohol to people, and we understand the effects of alcohol. And we're confident, extremely confident, we provide safe environments to our patrons, not only through COVID, but with the effects of alcohol. So, you know, if there was anybody getting out of their seat or coming within 6 feet or taking their mask off, if they were walking to or from the bathroom or in and outside of the building, we can enforce those rules. We do enforce rules every single day when it comes to alcohol and within our taprooms as well.
And so not a mandate anymore, but small business owners know you're investing in equipment and making sure you have the right people. And so this impacted brewery business models regardless, even if the mandate is no longer there.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, a lot of the breweries, like I said, who are relying on third parties, whether it be food trucks or caterer or someone else, you know, and they were doing, let's say, halfway decent through COVID. You know, they decided to take some of those funds and implement those food programs more permanently. So installing kitchens or installing small fryers or grills and doing the food themselves. So, you know, people have been really responsive to that and really excited that they can go to a brewery and sit down and have food and beer all made by that site as well. The other business model we've seen is breweries bringing in restaurants that may have closed, bringing in those chefs and giving them an opportunity to be employed. Use more of a test kitchen where they can come in for a certain amount of time, whether it's, you know, a month per month or whether it's a 6 month basis, they can come in and try maybe a new restaurant concept, but give some opportunities to restaurants and to chefs that may have either lost their business or lost their job.
Again, you're hearing Where We Live as we talk about the local craft brew industry. My guest, Phil Pappas, Executive Director of the Connecticut Brewers Guild. You can join us. We'd love to hear from you about which breweries you go to in your neighborhood. I know that my family checks out Powder Hill Brewery in Enfield, also yeah. Broadbrook, that just opened up a space a couple years ago in Suffield, right on the border of Suffield and Windsor. You can join us as well, 888-720-9677. Or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. So we did talk to Brewers Association Chief Economist Bart Watson, and he did describe how these business models had to deal with changing from wholesale and tap room sales. And so would you say that for the businesses that are open and doing well, that's made them more sustainable, Phil?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we did see draft sales significantly decline when restaurants were under the same mandates that we were. But draft has come back. Bart spoke very, very eloquently at our Craft Brewers Conference in regards to draft being back, which is great. There increased competition, of course, with seltzers and ready-to-drink cocktails that are out there. It seems like there's a new brand every single time I go into the package store. But, you know, that's why we allowed breweries to have multi-manufacturing permits. So breweries can now brew wine, manufacture spirits, manufacture cider, and keep it in with themselves as well. So, you know, we've seen a lot of shifts of different business models come into the brewing industry. And distribution has been a great asset to making money and providing jobs within the industry. Breweries are able to self-distribute as well. So there's a lot of great retailers out there, a lot of great supporters, and they're realizing that craft beer is one of the best options for them to provide in their sales. I mean, Jamal can definitely speak. I mean, New England Brewing Company, Seahag, is the number one SKU in Connecticut. It's on the shelves and it flies. So it's really great to see the support from these local retailers as well. And I think that was one of the best, one of the silver linings during COVID was people realized how important it was to support local.
You referenced Jamal Robinson, who's still with us, Director of Sales and Marketing at New England Brewing Company, or NEBCO, in Woodbridge. Jamal, what did you want to add?
Yeah, I think Phil's right in terms of speaking about how the people got up and supported local. Our tap room, even though we had to shut down, we did to-go service, and people pulling up with lines, getting cases to go, tipping the staff incredibly well, knowing that, you know, service relies heavily on those tips. People really showed up and supported. It was pretty amazing to see. As a brand, we actually had to shut down the brewery. We split our team into two teams. We didn't officially shut down, but we split our entire company into two teams that operated opposite weeks, which was basically running the brewery on a bare bones team each week, just to make sure if there was an exposure. We didn't know how long COVID was going to last or how bad it was going to get. So if there was an exposure, we'd be able to still operate the brewery. And the customers that supported us, the wholesaler network that supported us, all the retailers that supported us, it was an incredible time, and the support was necessary.
Phil, I mentioned at the top that, you know, during the pandemic, about a dozen breweries closed, but I believe another 22 opened. I think one of them is Space Cat, which is a tap room forward, who's actually a tap room forward model. They have a big tap room in South Norwalk. I'm wondering if you can talk about that. He told us that it was not the norm.
Yeah, so we've seen a shift in what brewery, just even the layout looks like. Over the last 10 years, a lot of the breweries were on a distribution model and said, let's make some really great beer and give it to some patrons to go, but most of it's going to be going out into the market, restaurants and package stores. So since we've allowed taproom sales in 2012, that's where the Guild got its start, of inception of allowing you to drink beer on site, we've seen that shift go to a taproom model. And the margins are a lot better for the breweries, you know, of course, on site and selling to go. So that's really where a lot of the models have gone. And we've seen taprooms open in that mindset of, hey, I'm just going to brew beer. I'm going to sell it on site, and people can take, you know, some of it to go. But I'm going to keep it really on site. And then they keep that model for a couple of years until they get to the point where people are asking for their beer across the state, or, you know, package store saying, hey, I'm getting so many inquiries for your beer. We want to be able to hold it. And then they start implementing some self-distribution and hiring somebody, which adds more jobs and adding a delivery driver to make those sales and get out there. And then we see that, it took breweries about 4 to 5 years to sign on with their distributor. We're seeing that come down into more of the 3-year mark now. So it is shifting where breweries are making more money on site. And then they're going to be able to feel more comfortable and have more money to be able to send out into the market through distribution.
Jamal, I mentioned that New England Brewing Company, or NEBCO's, in Woodbridge, you know, their plans to expand or to relocate. Can you tell us about that and how, you know, the pivot during the pandemic, you know, how that may be encouraging this expansion or relocation?
We've been trying to expand for the last several years now, looking at different spaces and trying to make that happen. We tried in Woodbridge here, we tried in New Haven, and an opportunity came up in West Haven, so we've been working on that for the last year plus. We've got another city council vote to get through, and if all goes according to plan, we'll hopefully be relocating over to West Haven, and this time next year we'll be in a new space. But it's been a need for us for several years now. We've been operating at capacity. We've squeezed more tanks into this building than anyone would believe possible. And we're making, this year we'll produce right around 20,000 barrels of beer just for Connecticut. All of that liquid going to Connecticut. So the need to expand for us has been pretty prevalent for the last few years now. So we're excited for the opportunity to be able to be in West Haven going forward.
You can join our conversation if you have questions about the local craft brew industry, or if you want to let us know which breweries you like to go to in your neighborhood. Again, our number 888-720-9677, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Phil, we talked to Jamal earlier about how the Brewers Guild is working with him and NEBCO on scholarship opportunities. So I'm wondering if you can talk about that, you know, this need, especially in our state, you know, to diversify, you know, who is working in this industry and also making space for people to feel comfortable.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Jamal nailed it on the head of the entire mission of our Connecticut Brewers Guild African American Brewing Science Scholarship at Sacred Heart. You know, and I wanted to mention, we started that program 3 years ago now. At Sacred Heart, we just got together and said, hey, we want to look at formalizing more of an education program in Connecticut. And Sacred Heart approached us, and we started looking at all these programs and started picking out the classes that sounded really cool and trying to develop the program in conjunction with the professors at Sacred Heart. And so that got up and running in 1 year. And it immediately, you know, with right after that, we said, all right, great, we got this program, but now who's going to be going through it? And that's where all those conversations with Jamal started happening. And we started looking at really being cognizant of the people that we're going to be putting through the program and that are going to come out of that program educated in Connecticut, that we're going to be going to the breweries and saying, hey, look at this person. They're educated. They're one of the first people to come out of the program. We got to give them an opportunity. And if we're going to be pushing people towards those breweries and making those connections and networking between, you know, Sacred Heart and the breweries, we need to be cognizant of who those people are and what better community to help out than the one that has been marginalized for generations, and give our opportunities to people that may not have had it before, or to Jamal's point before, even felt comfortable with even taking that first step. And I think that's one of the biggest things that we've been able to do is sit down with people that have shown even the smallest interest, whether it be at the Change in the Air Festival or people coming into the tap room. And, you know, you go into NEBCO and the scholarship posters are all plastered. And, you know, as soon as we see anybody showing any interest, we're sitting down with them, having a beer, talking about the program, talking about internships. And that's one of the things that this scholarship provides as well, is that they get an internship right at NEBCO. Right after the program. So they're already in line to have a good paying job. And that's something that we're looking at the beer industry as well, as providing great jobs to great people.
You know, earlier on the show, about a year ago, we talked to women brewers and others who didn't feel comfortable always where they work. And I'm wondering, you know, through the work of the Guild and what you're seeing in local breweries about gender diversity and making changes there. I'm curious your thoughts there.
Yeah, absolutely. We've made some really great strides over the last couple of years in diversity, inclusion, and equity, but we have so much further to go. And we've been working very closely with Jamal and the Change in the Air Foundation and getting that formalized. And that has so many goals. I'm so happy to see where it's come and where it's going. But we also have our Pink Boot Society, which is all women run organization about beer education and beer jobs and careers for women in the industry. So having those two pivots for the Connecticut Brewers Guild and our entire industry. And we're constantly talking about it at our meetings with our breweries, saying, are you implementing anything at your brewery? What are you implementing? We partner with the Alliance to End Sexual Violence to talk about, excuse me, discrimination against women in the workplace as well. And are you being cognizant of who you're hiring? Have you gone through, there's studies that show that if you do a blind resume where you don't look at the name, you know, just look at their job experience, there's led to more diversity that way as well. We're putting a lot of resources in the hands of breweries, because they are businesses. A lot of these businesses, breweries have just gotten up and running, and, you know, they're just kind of figuring it out as they go. This is a new industry, but we're providing them the resources. The entire point of why the Guild exists is to provide the resources to these businesses so that they are doing a good job and being a good community supporter. And that's something that, like, again, we've made some really great strides, and we've been putting a lot of great emphasis on diversity, equity, inclusion, but there's so much work to be done. It is nowhere close to what the actual population of Connecticut looks like. It is the complete inverse. So we need to change that, and we are changing that.
Jamal, before we end, we're talking about, you know, again, making this inclusive also for women and others. And I understand there's a women's summit coming up in New Haven. What can you tell us?
Yeah. Jess Bautista, my fiance, is hosting and organizing a women's summit. And it's a concept. It's called She's Into Beer. And the idea is that they're bringing women from all different parts of the beer industry. So from sales, from marketing, to brewing, to ownership and taproom ownership, even some of the scholarship recipients will be there. Some of the recent graduates from the brewing science program. There's going to be a sensory portion of that. So getting to have these panel discussions, hearing from women that are in the industry, but also women that are not in the industry to be able to go to something like this. It'll be a beer fest kind of sampling opportunity there. One of the head person of sensory at Two Roads is going to be there as well to provide sampling through hops and understanding how to sample beer and what that really means. So educational and fun, but also just a really cool space for women to be able to be amongst one another, to learn about the industry, to learn about beer in general, and just and hear these voices of some women that are doing some really awesome things in this business, especially locally.
That's good to hear. Jamal Robinson, again, is Director of Sales and Marketing at New England Brewing Company. Jamal, thanks for your time on the show.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
You're listening to Where We Live on Connecticut Public. Staying with us is Phil Pappas, Executive Director of the Connecticut Brewers Guild. Coming up, we're going to hear more about breweries in our state, including the Brewers Association naming Athletic Brewing one of the top 50 producing craft brewing companies in the U.S. This is based in Stratford. They make non-alcoholic products. More after a short break. This is Where We Live on Connecticut Public. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. Today we've been talking about the craft brew industry in Connecticut, also learning about national trends. Juan sent us a message on Facebook, wanted to shout out Hanging Hills Brewery. That's in Hartford. Now, when we talk about national trends, again, we spoke with Bart Watson, chief economist at the Brewers Association, and he explained the success of the craft brewing industry more broadly. Let's take a listen.
Craft brewing has grown every year since we started measuring in the early 1980s. So seeing the declines, you know, 10% in 2020 in terms of production volume that we saw during COVID was, you know, really a shock and shows how dramatically the market changed during the immediate COVID period.
Again, my guest is Phil Pappas, Executive Director of Connecticut Brewers Guild. You know, Watson also noted, Phil, the craft beer market was starting to see signs of maturity and there might be potential for saturation. What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, absolutely, Bart. Bart's been on this for a while, and we've been, you know, getting these questions, you know, the forever question, is there a bubble? And, you know, Connecticut still ranks in the middle of the pack when it comes to breweries per capita. We rank 25th in that. So we only have 3.2 breweries per 100,000 people here in Connecticut that are 21 and over. When you look at states like Vermont, Vermont is actually number one. They have 13.5. So very still a lot of room for growth for us here in Connecticut. You know, we have examples in Manchester where we have 4 breweries for 60,000 people. So they're all doing well. So there is our examples of really great communities. And as long as people continue to show out for the breweries, continue to support them, there's no reason why we can't support more.
Before the break, I mentioned Athletic Brewing in Stratford. Can you tell us about them?
Yeah. Yeah, Athletic is such a great partner, such a great addition to this craft beer industry, and they've taken the non-alcoholic market by storm. You know, when you think about non-alcoholic beer, O'Doul's is the only one that really comes to mind. It's kind of your, you know, your grandfather's non-alcoholic beer, right? You know, and you know, some people, it's just not a good beer, in my opinion. It doesn't taste good. But Athletic has completely changed what you think about non-alcoholic beer. And they were just ranked, and they can't stop winning awards. They were ranked Time Magazine top 100 companies, not just in beer, just in general top 100 companies. They're now on their third location in 4 years in Milford. And adding so much more production to that. And all their beers are so good. It's what I drink during the week. It's what I'm cooking with dinner. And it's really true to style beer. So they have their New England IPAs, they have their stouts, they have their sours, they have their light pilsners and lagers. And so they really are taking over the entire non-alcoholic game. And what we're really seeing too is Connecticut breweries are putting them in their tap rooms as well. So if somebody comes into a brewery at NEPCO and they're like, hey, I don't want to drink a beer today, or, you know, I'm driving and they want to be responsible, and they're offering them non-athletic brewing. So they've been such a great addition. They're really adding to this, brew without compromise mindset.
Right. I wanted to circle back to something you mentioned earlier, you know, challenges that remain. We're seeing in our region CO2 shortages, a WBUR out of Boston reporting on night shift brewery in Mass because of their CO2 supplier won't be able to deliver to them for more than a year. They're going to be cutting their staff by half. And so are you concerned at all in Connecticut about this potential shortage?
Yeah, absolutely. We are. It's something that is just heartbreaking to see happen to such a great brewery in Night Shift up in Massachusetts. And they're right over the border. They're not too far from us here in Connecticut. We've been working very closely with our CO2 suppliers in Connecticut, and we don't have any scares like that yet. However, if we don't have the CO2 shortage come back, or if the cost is going to significantly increase, we could see some breweries either pull back on their production, and really, really hoping that we don't see any closures due to it. It's heartbreaking to see a brewery go through so much heart, blood, sweat, and tears to open and operate within the space, deal with the last 2.5 years that we've dealt with, and then come out of it. We're through this, the light at the end of the tunnel, and you know, you're hit yet again with another supply issue. And it's heartbreaking to see, and we're staying on top of it. We're constantly seeing what's happening in other states. We work very closely with the Brewers Association, but also with all the other state guild directors, talking constantly with them about what they're seeing, and we're trying to keep our finger on the pulse in every facet of this business.
We're almost out of time, Phil. I'm just wondering, when you think about some of the legislative priorities moving forward, any possible changes with delivery options? I understand direct-to-consumer shipping maybe in the horizon. What can you tell us?
Yeah, absolutely. So we during COVID, we got the allowance for breweries to do home delivery, which has been really great. It kept a lot of the employees just having a job and doing something in the brewery. But, you know, we're looking at how beer is delivered to people and how the beer act is available to people. So we're looking at direct to consumer shipping here in Connecticut, because we are looking on a national level to allow the United States Postal Service through the USPS Shipping Equity Act for them to deliver beer and deliver alcohol. So we're looking, if that does pass, when we're looking at that on a congressional level, if that passes, then we are already behind the ball here in Connecticut, because we don't have the allowance right now for breweries to ship direct beer directly to people. Wineries and cideries in Connecticut have that allowance, and we don't. And we don't think that it's a level playing field in that area. And it's something that we think breweries should absolutely have an access to. So we're trying to change that legislatively, and we're hoping to get that done in 2023.
That's Phil Pappas, Executive Director again of Connecticut Brewers Guild. Phil, thank you for your time on the show. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And appreciate all the support from the consumers out there.
I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Today's show produced by Katie Pellico. Our technical director is Kat Pastor. You can download Where We Live anytime on your favorite podcast app. Thanks for listening.